Hey, sixth grade, Mr. Herzberg here, and today we are going to be doing, it's Friday, so you know what that means, your daily journal and the adventures of Tom Sawyer. So, we're going to be doing a few things today. Before we get to that though, we need to go ahead and make sure we got some housekeeping here. Today is April the 17th, and we're going to be working on chapter 7 of Tom Sawyer. So we'll go over chapter 6 a little bit and then our journal. So let's get started with the journal then. So remember this week, guys, you were just working with text evidence. And basically that just means anytime you read something and you are asked questions about what you read, you need to prove where you got your answers from. And we call that text evidence. And whenever you use text evidence, there's something you need to be careful of doing. You never want to copy word for word what your evidence is. You try and want to paraphrase it. Remember what paraphrase means? Paraphrase means to put it in your own words. Try and steer away from copying verbatim, that means word for word, your answers. So let's go ahead today and see what our journal is for citing text evidence. Let's see here. We're going to be reading about the mystery of Mary Celeste. And the Mary Celeste was a boat that sailed about, they found it abandoned 400 miles east of the Azores in December of 1872. So you're going to read all about that. There's about, five paragraphs here about the Mary Celeste. And then one big question for the journal today. And that question is, explain why what happened to the crew and passengers of the Mary Celeste is a big mystery. So you're going to read about this boat, you're going to read about how it was found completely abandoned of its crew, and then there's some theories here they've got about what may have happened to her crew. So for today's journal, just give me, I'd say, 5 sentences with your claim backed up with text evidence. Remember, a claim needs evidence. It's like a hypothesis. You need something to back it up, okay? You can't just state something. Okay, and that's the journal for today. So that's it for that. Let's go ahead and go over our homework from the other night, which was Wednesday night, was chapter 6 of Tom Sawyer. And if you came, some of you came to my Google Meets live chat, we went over the answers today. But if you weren't there, this is for you. Why is Tom late for school in Chapter 6? Well, he is hanging out with the one and only Huckleberry Finn. It's Monday, the day after Bible school, the chapter where he gets the Bible, and on his way to school, Tom gets waylaid by his good buddy, Huckleberry Finn. And they start talking, and Huckleberry Finn starts talking all sorts of nonsense. We'll get to that. What did Tom pretend was the matter with him so he didn't have to go to school? Well, he tried 2 things to get his Aunt Polly to kind of fall for his shenanigans. He tried first playing hooky by saying his toe was sore. He even fooled his cousin Sid, who's usually pretty hard to fool. And Sid ran downstairs, got his Aunt Polly. She came up, she looked at his toe. She said, "There's nothing wrong with your toe, Tom. Anything else?" And he goes, "Yeah, it's my tooth now." She examined his tooth. She said, your tooth is loose. And she had a plan for it. So let's go to the next question. Why was Tom forbidden to play with Huckleberry Finn? Well, Huckleberry Finn is a huge character in Mark Twain's world. He's so much so he even gets his own sequel to this called The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn. But long story short, for our book's purposes, he is the son of the town drunk. The town drunk who is allowed pretty much to lay around all day in an old cabin / shack off the outskirts of town in Missouri, while his son, Huckleberry, wanders the town barefooted and wearing nothing but overalls. No school, no church, the kid's free to do what he likes. And so none of the parents want his ways rubbing off on their children. What did Huck say dead cats could cure? Warts. Don't ask how or why, that's just what he believes. Why did Tom tell the truth about talking to Huck Finn and being late to school? One reason, when he gets to Mr. Dobbins' class, he says, "Mr. Dobbins, I'm late." Mr. Dobbins goes, "Where were you, Tom?" Tom says, "Well, I was hanging out with Huckleberry Finn." And he's proud, he looks around the class. Mr. Dobbins beats him with a ruler because beating kids was legal back then in the 1800s. And he says, go sit with the girls. Tom is glad to sit with the girls because his crush, Becky Thatcher, is over there. Moving on. So, how did Aunt Polly use a chunk of wood to pull out Tom's loose tooth? Kind of like child abuse here. It's really strange. But anyways, she grabs a piece of twine, like sewing thread. She ties it around the loose tooth. She then grabs the other end of it. She gets a piece of hot wood, flaming wood from the fireplace. Acts like she's going to jam it in her child's face. When he rears back at flinching, the tooth comes loose. Child abuse or clever, your choice. But that's what happens. Tom and Huck demonstrate lots of superstitions and lack of scientific knowledge, list their cures for warts. Okay, this is great. So these kids think you can get a dead cat to cure warts. You can stick your hand in old rainwater that's collected in a stump. They call it spunk water. And the third thing is to go to a cemetery and say some special incantations. Kids in the 1800s, right? This is what we have with internet these days. Why do people believe in superstitions? Well, we believe in superstitions because if something happens and we can't explain it, we tend to fall back on superstitions to fill in the gap there. How did Tom use his tardiness to win Becky's attention? What might have been a better punishment? Well, he walks into the class, as I said before. He tells Mr. Dobbins, I'm late because I was playing with Huck Finn. He's showing off in front of the class, and specifically Becky. So that's what he was trying to do. Maybe a better punishment for Tom would have been to sit by himself, but not with the girls. That was exactly what he wanted. Why did Becky think Tom was just a special guy? Well, it's because he's impressing her. He's showing off. He's going by her house. He's doing cartwheels. He's throwing flowers into her yard. He's sitting next to her in class. He's making her giggle. He's drawing pictures on his chalkboard of Mr. Dobbins. And it just he's making her laugh. And lastly, what is one example of just desserts from Chapter 6? Well, Tom's little plans with his Aunt Polly, up to this point, anytime Tom had tried to do something, he got out of it. Got out of the fence painting, he got out of being late for class, but one time with Aunt Polly, he could not get out of going to school, right? He won a Bible by selling stuff, but not this time. He finally got payback. So let's get started. I'm going to read a little bit of Chapter 7, then I'm leaving the rest to you guys. Don't forget to like and subscribe to this video. Down below, click the subscribe button, click the bell. That way, a good thumbs up. And heck, even leave a positive comment. So anytime Mr. Herzberg uploads, you'll know. And you go straight to Google Classroom and find your questions and watch my video. Okay? But always watch my videos first and then do your homework. Okay? And the readings. Let's get started with Chapter 7. Now, Chapter 7 goes from page 50. And it's a super short chapter, 54. It's only 3 pages. I'm going to read a little bit of it. You know the drill. I'll give the rest to you. Chapter 7, a treaty entered into, early lessons, and a mistake has been made. The harder Tom tried to fasten his mind on his book, more his ideas wandered. So at last, with a sigh and a yawn, he gave it up. It seemed to him that the noon recess would never come. The air was utterly dead. There was not breathing and stirring. It was the sleepiest of sleepy days at school. The drowsing murmur of the 25 studying scholars soothed the soul like the spell is in the murmur of bees. Away off in the flaming sunshine of Cardiff Hill lifted a soft green side through a shimmering veil of heat. Tinted, purple distance, a few birds floating on lazily with the high wind. No other living thing was visible but some cows, and they were asleep. Tom's heart ached to be free. Or else something else would happen of interest to do to help pass this dreary time in school. His hand wandered from his pocket into his face, lit with a glow of gratitude that was prayer, though he didn't know it. Then furtively the percussion cap box came out. He released the tick and put it down on the long, flat desk. Ah, he's got his bug, right? A little tick. The creature probably glowed with gratitude that amounted to prayer too at this moment, but it was premature, for when he started thankfully to travel off, Tom turned him aside with a pen and made him take a new direction. Tom's bosom friend next to him, suffering just as Tom had been, and now he was deeply and gratefully interested in this entertainment. In an instant, this bosom friend was his good buddy Joe Harper. These two boys were sworn friends all the week and embattled enemies on Saturdays. Joe took a pin out of his lapel and began to also assist in exorcising the prisoner, Tick. The sport grew in interest momentarily. Soon Tom said that they were interfering with each other and neither getting the fullest benefit of the Tick. So he put Joe's slate on the desk and drew a little line down the middle from top to bottom. "Now," he said, "as long as he's on your side, you can stir him up and I'll let him alone. But if he let him get away and he gets to my side, Joe, well, you're going to leave him alone as long as I can keep him from crossing over. All right, Tom, you go ahead. You start first." The Tick escaped from Tom presently and then crossed the equator. Joe harassed the insect for a while, and then he got away and crossed back again. This change of base occurred often. While one boy was worrying the Tick with absorbing interest, the other would look on with interest, so strong the two heads bowed together over the slate, and the two souls dead to all things else. At last, luck seemed to settle in and abide with Joe. The Tick tried this and that and the other course, and got as excited and as anxious as the boys themselves. But this time and again, just as he would get victory and very gassed to speak and Tom's fingers would be twitching to begin with, Joe's pins would deftly head him off and keep procession. At last, Tom could stand it no more. The temptation was too strong. So he reached out and lent a hand with his pin. Joe was angry in a moment and said, "Tom, leave him alone." "Oh, come on, Joe. I only want to stir him up just a little." "No, sir, Tom Sawyer. It ain't fair. You just let him alone." "Ah, blame it, Joe. I ain't going to stir him much." "Let him alone, Tom. I'm going to tell you. I'm not doing anything." "Tom, you're going to do it. He's on my side of the line. You know the rules. Look here, Joe Harper. Whose Tick is that anyways?" "I don't care whose Tick it is. He's on my side of the line, and you ain't going to touch him." "Well, I'll just bet I will, though. He's my Tick, and I'll do what I want with him. Or I'll die." Then a tremendous whack came down on Tom's shoulders and duplicated on Joe's, and for the space of 2 minutes, the dust continued to fly from the two jackets, and the whole school was laughing and enjoying it. The boys had been so absorbed to even notice the hush upon the school, while before them, Master Dobbins came tiptoeing down the room and right to him. He had contemplated a good part of the performance before he contributed his bit to the variety. When school broke up at noon, Tom flew to Becky Thatcher and whispered in her ear, "Oh, Becky, put your bonnet on and let on you're going home. And when you get to the corner, give the rest of them a slip and turn right on down through the lane and come back. I'll go the other way and come on in the same way." And so they went off with one group of scholars and the other in another. In a little while, they met at the bottom of the lane, and when they reached the school, they had it all to themselves. Then they held their hands, gilding it, and so created another surprising house. When this interest in art began to wane, the two fell to talking. Tom, swimming in bliss, he said, "Do you love rats, Becky?" "Ugh, I hate them." "Well, I do too. Live ones. But I mean dead ones, Becky. You know, swing around your head with a string." "Ugh, no, I don't care for rats much anyway. What I like is chewing gum." "Oh, I should say so. Oh, Becky, I wish I had some right now." "Do you? Well, I've got some. I'll let you chew it a while, but you must give it back to me." That was agreeable, and so they chewed the gum, turned it, and then dangled their teeth and their legs, the bench in excess of contentment. "Was you ever in a circus, Becky?" asked Tom. "Yep, and my pa's gonna take me again sometime soon if I'm good." "Well, I've been to the circus, and let me tell you, I've been 3 or 4 times. Lots of times. Church ain't shucks to a circus. There's all sorts of things at a circus all the time. Well, I'm gonna be a clown when I grow up." "Oh, Tom, are you? That'll be nice. They're so lovely, all spotted up." "That's so. And as they get slathers of money, you know most clowns make about $1 a day." "Mm-hmm. Ben Rogers says, well, say, Becky, you ever engaged, was that? Why, engaged, you know, to be married." "No." "You want to?" "I reckon. What's it like?" "Like? What? It ain't like anything, Becky. You only just tell a boy you won't have any other boy but him. Ever, ever, ever. And then you kiss him and all, and anybody can do it." All right, I'm going to stop there because things are getting nice and weird. Tom and Becky are hanging out, chapter 7. Don't forget to do the questions. If you don't understand any of this, come to my Google Meet, 1 to 1:30 tomorrow. Catch you guys later, sixth grade.